Vaheguru Ji Ka Khalsa, Vaheguru Ji Ki Fateh. Hope you can all hear me clearly. It's our first live broadcast. So yeah, this Reddit is a website, and the people on there have been asking for a while for me to host an AMA, ask me anything. So this is our version of trying to answer the questions from the people on there. There's been a Sevadar who's very kindly put all the questions together. That were put up by all the Sangat, so I'm going to go through them one by one. The first question is, there are people that are suggesting that murder or revenge, murder might be an appropriate form of revenge for destroying a sloop of Guru Granth Sahib Ji. This has already started happening. So they asked me, what is my position? Should Sikhs be seeking revenge or justice for damage done to a sloop of Guru Granth Sahib Ji? Well, yes, there should be justice. If somebody has damaged Guru Granth Sahib Ji, that is a heinous crime. Guru Granth Sahib Ji is the most precious thing in the world for a Sikh. So it's a heinous crime, and we should seek to get justice for that. The question is, who should we seek justice from? Can we expect justice from the Indian government? I would say at the current moment, no, we can't expect that. Can we expect justice from the SGPC? Are they going to do something? I would say again, SEC, they have proven themselves to be quite inept, and so we can't look there. So unfortunately, whilst there is no... can we expect justice from the Jathedars that were supposedly elected by the Panth last year in the Sarbat Khalsa? Again, I would say they're too busy at the moment preparing for the next Sarbat Khalsa. And the question would be, that are they going to do anything more than just do, protests on the street and again appeal to the government to give us justice? So again, I think that we're not going to expect much from there. So unfortunately, in the current situation, I don't advocate any violence, but I would expect that people would take justice into their own hands. What's my position? As I said, we should not allow someone to get away with destroying Guru Granth Sahib Ji or ripping the page of Guru Granth Sahib Ji and these things. That should not be allowed. But given the laws of the country we're in, I want to make clear that I'm not advocating violence. I'm just saying that we need to perhaps, the better system would be for us to set up, because the second question is, what can we do to stop people from doing murder? And has been articulated. So what should we do? The first three questions are all about this. So I think that the best thing would be to set up a system. And effectively what you need is a parallel court, a court of the Sikhs, where we have judges, we have people that advocates that are presenting the case for, and also a defense given to anybody who's accused. And then really, if you have a Sikh criminal court, and it's independent in the sense that it's run by Sikhs, we could probably then seek to get some kind of justice from that court. And that probably would only come about if we had a hierarchy above it, in the sense that we had a Jathedar of the Qaum, and maybe some Panch Jathedar of the Qaum. If we elected that, then we could have them set up a independent criminal court. And that court could then examine cases, arrest people. But then what we're talking about is effectively a parallel government to the Indian government, especially in terms of issues that are critical for Sikhs, so we can give our own justice. This is not going to happen so quickly in India. So because the system doesn't exist, and the courts are not supporting us, our own politics are corrupt and infested with this virus of the SGPC. So we're going to find ourselves unable to solve these problems for the future. And therefore, vigilantism, I think, is probably going to carry on occurring. The question number four, what do you think about your interactions with the likes of Dava Man, Ali Dava, Hamza? How frustrating does it get for you when you talk with them? Well, yeah, it's very frustrating sometimes. But only if they don't listen. What I find sometimes is that you'll answer a question that was asked to you, and it will be a clear answer. And what will happen is they will just sidestep the answer and go off somewhere else because they don't want to deal with that answer. And that's sometimes a bit frustrating. That happened with Hamza, and it happened with Ali Davo when a question was asked. They kept repeating back dogma rather than answering the question. So what I find with them is that if you make a good point, instead of thinking, oh, let me listen to that point, because like at one point in the video with Hamza, he asked a good question. And because I was genuinely trying to talk to him, he asked me a good question and I paused, I thought about it, and then I was going to give him the answer. I gave him the answer. But I found that as soon as I gave him the answer and he answered the question, he then went off straight away on a sidestep and started talking about something completely separate from what we talked about, in a way to not give credence to my answer. So the question, carrying on with that question, it was said, do you feel they're not actually there to learn about Sikhi, but more so to criticize, downgrade it in comparison to Islam? 100% I think that they aim to criticize and downgrade other religions in comparison to Islam. You just have to understand that. I think what we can learn from these interactions is that these people exist. And to be honest, these are the most polite versions of the Dawa men out there. If you go to the streets of Luton, Bradford, Leeds, Manchester, our youth all across the country, Birmingham, you know, our youth all across the country are being effectively challenged by very similar people. They're with very, very similar points, okay? Even this morning, I was talking to a guy from a very Muslim-dominated area, and he said that many of the Sikhs in the school find it hard there because when Sikhs in religious studies, they bring up Sikhism, you know, a lot of people laugh and snigger when the teacher is teaching them about Sikhism because they see it. They don't understand it, and most of them are very clear that nothing out there can compare to the Quran. So yeah, absolutely. I think that most of them are looking to criticize and downgrade it in order to promote their religion, and they're very open about that. I don't think you should assume that they are not there for that. I don't think you should assume that they're going to be like us. Ki tumko tumhara khub, humko humara khub. I think that's a bad assumption to make. I think you should just expect that they are going to try and catch you off guard and try and not listen to you. And you're going to have to be quite strong. And that's why we call it arm yourself with knowledge. I think you should be ready and be prepared to stand your ground, no matter how many of them are there. And stay strong in your belief and refute them. Now, the next question is, is there a reason why you have avoided talking about the inaccuracies and contradictions within the Quran? I recall that Ali Dawa guy brought this up in his guidelines for what makes a book the eternal truth, and I felt that all of his points could have been refuted easily. So this question was asked by many of you, why don't you just counterattack? The thing here is, though, you know, we could come up with a lot of points, and I don't think that we're the only people that come up with those points. There's many, many websites that are dedicated to attacking Islam, pointing out all the inaccuracies. Many, many bloggers. There's even ex-Muslim bloggers who will spend their time. You can check out the guy Converted to Islam, bringing out a whole bunch of videos that are about the inaccuracies and also the contradictions and also sometimes the moral principles and how abhorrent some of those can be. And they're out there. I don't think there's any point, really, of me bringing it up with these people. Maybe a few things you could, for example, slavery, because it's something that's very hard to refute. But most of the time, what's going to happen is that these guys are never going to accept it in the first place. They're always going to find some excuse. And believe you me, every single one of these points that you will bring up, there is an Islamic answer, which most of the time only makes sense to those that are people who are of a Muslim background. And everybody else was like, I'm not sure I agree with that. But they will give you that answer and they will try their best to defend Islam. So don't expect them to take any of those points on board. In order to educate the audience, you might say that. But to be honest, you're going to come across quite negative. I feel that I would come across quite negative in trying to attack the Quran, because more of them would join and it would become into more of an aggressive argument. Just standing there and talking about Sikhi and just batting off all of their attacks, I feel is a better way of explaining to people what Sikhi is. Because what's going to happen then is it will be like, oh, you see that guy? You see it? He's just here to attack us. And he's there to make us look bad. And then every time you go somewhere, they're going to have, you as a Islamophobe and all this kind of stuff. And the other thing to remember is we do take part in wider media debates. And if you start attacking Islam, there is a whole movement of people dedicated to finding people who either criticize Islam in the slightest way, and they will just use that against you to discredit you in any public sphere. So me personally, I don't feel there's much of a point, nothing to be achieved from doing that. It's better to just teach those things to our youth. For example, we could make a video explaining what we don't agree with in the Quran. And we actually made one of those already, not specifically like that, but talking about what is Guru Granth Sahib Ji, Islam versus Sikhism. We made the anti-conversion series about videos about what they say to you, how you can defend back. So we've tried to cope with those things, but we don't necessarily try attack the Quran. And in a way, there's two reasons as well that I think that are important from a Sikh point of view. Firstly, in the 52 hukums of Guru Gobind Singh Ji and Hazur Sahib, Guru Sahib says, study all religions, but don't do nindya of any religion, which is to criticize it. Now you might say, I'm not falsely criticizing, because nindya intends to be like more slander, yeah, based upon untruths. So in a way, if you do look at things that are Sahih Hadiths and Quran itself, then maybe you can say, well, it's not slander. The other thing is that in Gurbani, the quote comes up when Maharaj says in Gurbani, they say, Ved Kateb Kahu Mat Chute, Chute Sona Bichare. They say, don't call them fools. Fools are those that don't contemplate upon the Vedas and the Abrahamic text and the scripture. So I feel it's better, like for example, in the video when he says, oh, but you said it's not a book of God. And I said, I never said that. You know, you're putting words in my mouth. You just got to be quite switched on in these debates and not get yourself drawn into making them. They will try and make it out that you hate Islam, and you got to be very clear that you don't, because we don't hate Islam. But they will assume that you do because you don't support them. It's a very them versus us mentality with most of these guys. If you're not with them, you're basically against them. Okay, the next question is a bit deep. So why do you believe in literal reincarnation and Dasam Dwar? The question carries on. The Sri Guru Granth Sahib Ji is very poetic and alludes to many things. In terms of death, concepts of heaven and hell are also brought up. Why do you pick one concept over the other? Also, what is your thought process in operating what is literal to what is metaphorical within the Sri Guru Granth Sahib Ji? So it's a big question. Now, why do I believe in a literal reincarnation? I think that's because I believe it. There's not a single, let's just say, the tradition that I come from, that I've learned from, are those people that are, like Mahapurks, you might say, people that have actually learned Gurbani, done a lot of Bhakti, a lot of meditation and spiritual Japtap. And they, all of them, the ones that I know about and the ones that I respect, whether it's from the AKJ, Jathebandi, the Taksal Jathebandi, the Sant Mahapurukh Jathebandiya, every single one has agreed with reincarnation. Okay, so I don't see how I, young person, not with that much bhakti, don't know that much Bani compared to these people, I don't see how I could look at them and say, oh, you must all be wrong. Actually, this thing doesn't exist. You're just taking it literally, but it doesn't exist. Based upon what? You know, when you've got a student, a 16-year-old student, they don't go up to a university lecturer and tell them they don't know anything about the topic they've been studying and practicing for so many years. I believe in it, A, because everybody who's made Sikhi come alive for me has believed in it. Secondly, I've met people that have talked about the fact that they've seen their previous lives, and they've seen future of people's lives, and they have been able to cope, and basically they, because of their own personal spiritual growth, they've been able to see into the past and the future for certain people, and also in their previous lives. So Asaki Fai Baba Harnam Singh Ji, obviously they talk about the previous life of a person who currently was a cripple. In his previous life, he'd use a stick. If a dog had stolen his food, he got angry with the dog, took a stick and broke its back. And in this life, he was suffering the consequences of that because he was basically, you know, he was crippled. Now, in terms of, again, reincarnation, I don't just believe in them for that reason, that the Mahapuruks talk about it. And but I also believe in it because Gurbani is always talking about them. Firstly, the Mool Mantra itself starts off with the idea of Ajuni. Now, there's a Jun life cycle, 84 lakh Jun upai. And Gurbani says, Manak ko pravdi vadiyai. The greatness is being given to human beings out of all the 8.4 million life forms. So these are Juns. Now, you might say, well, everybody's in a Jun. Agala Puruk is not in a Jun. But when we look at the Jun thing, it's always a life cycle that you go from one Jun to the next Jun. Yeah. So Gurbani talks about that. And it talks about what would happen at the last moment of your death. And what if you don't have your mind at the right place, that you will then consign yourself to suffering in the wrong June. So, Antaka jo Lakshmi simre, aisi chinta mein jai mare, sarp joan val val autare. So, Talochanji's famous Shabad basically says, at the last moment of your life, it's quite clear, Antakal, at the last time of your life, if you think about money, then you come back as a snake. It says, goes on, if you think about your family, you come back as a, I think it's a pig. If you think about the other sex, you come back as a prostitute. If you think about, if you think about your houses, you come back into the ghost life cycle. And then finally, if you think about God, then you can get liberation. And absolutely, we believe, you know, the same way. So I believe in Dharmaraj. I believe in the June life cycle. I believe in reincarnation. And as I've said in many videos, that there is concepts of heaven and hell given in Sikhi. We can't ignore them just because maybe we don't understand them. One thing that always annoys me is the sheer arrogance of some people who don't seem to know that much Bani, and who've not really hung out with people that have actually earned Gurbani, right? To then just stand up and pass judgment on what Gurbani is really saying. You know, this kind of literal versus poetic and alluding. I don't think Guru Granth Sahib Ji is full of things that are not real, that the Guru was just alluding to in order to sound nice and poetic. I think Guru Granth Sahib Ji is fully the truth. And the Guru is not going to try to confuse us because the world is confusing enough already. Yeah. So the Guru is saying that there are these people called Jamduts, the messengers of death, and there is a Jamaraj, the king of death. Then I believe it's true. And just to give you a bit more of an idea, like, so Guru Ram Das Ji Maharaj in Asa Diwar is saying that Jini Aisa Har Namna Chetyo Se Kahe Jag Aaye Ram Raji Eh Manas Janam Dulamb Hai Naam Bina Birtha Sab Jaye. Maharaj says this human life is hard to find, dulamb. Now, if you only had one life, why would they say it's hard to find that life? Everybody who had that life, right? They just have that life. Everybody can only have one life. So what's the hard to find bit? Unless there was 8.4 million of them, and then this was just one of them. And therefore, it would be hard to find, because obviously there's people in England that play lottery, and lottery tickets are like 8 million to one chance of winning, and not everybody's won the lottery. So you could say it's hard to win the lottery, but it's even harder, yeah, to be winning the human life. So that's the first one. So in that Shabad, then Maharaj carries on. They say ki hunvate harnamana bijyo agge pukha kya khai. In this life, if you don't jap naam, then in the next world, what will you eat? Now, if we're going to say agge pukha kya, what does that agge mean? You know, when Maharaj says, Age sukh mere mita, pache anand prav kita. When they're saying that, age, that's in the next world. Ehe lok sukhi hai, par lok suhele. This world will be sukhi and the next world. So in Gurbani, it's always talking about the next world. In fact, the Shabad by Bhagat Namdev Ji, where he talks about the place called Begumpura, Begumpura Shahar Kona. And in that place called Begumpura, what you've got is, you've got this town where everybody's friendly, everybody is, no one's being persecuted, everybody's getting along. If you look in Japji Sahib, you've got Guruji talking about where is God, where is your home, what is that place where you are. And that's basically for me, Sachkhand. They ask that question twice in Japji Sahib and in Rara Sahib in the Sodar Pori. And then the answer comes back, it's a place where there's always music playing. It's a place where there's so many musicians. There's so many people singing your praise. Every type of being is singing your praise. So for me, that is a description of heaven. That is a place where people are singing Kirtan. And the other thing is that in that Shabad Mara says, the same Shabad by Guru Ram Dashi in Asa Diwar, they say, ki, agge pukha kya khai. So we got a place future. So we can call that Sachkhand or Begumpura or Amarpuri, okay, or, you know. And then they say, ki manmukha no fir janam hai, nanak harpai. That the people that don't listen to the Guru and they don't follow this path, then they have to be reborn. Fir janam hai. Fir, there's no, I can't see any other translations of fir janam hai apart from being reborn. So again, for me, that confirms that there is rebirth. Okay. Now, another thing to remember is that, you know, when we're talking about, is Guru Sahib going to put something in that's just not meant to be literal? Well, you know, when we talk about the idea of karam, at 6 years old, Guru Nanak Dev Ji Maharaj is saying to people that dada dos na diyo kise, dos karma apniya, jo main kiya, so main paya, dos na dije avardana. This is in Patti Likhi Shabd. Maharaj says, don't blame anybody. Whatever you've done, so shall you reap. Because it's all because of our own karma, our own karma. But when a six-year-old child is saying that, when you've got a four-year-old child who's born with, you know, a serious, you know, maybe he's losing, he hasn't got a leg or hasn't got an arm, and you say to that child, well, Guruji says that it's all your own fault because of your own karma, that four-year-old is going to say, hold on, I've done nothing wrong to anybody, I'm only four. What will you answer to that person? Well, the thing is in the Western concept, we have this idea that every child is innocent, okay? So when a child dies early, they say, oh, it's okay, the child died innocent, never got to earn any sins. But we don't have that concept that every single person is innocent, because Guru Sahib is telling us that no one is innocent. Everybody is coming with all of their previous lives, you know, millions of lives they've had. All the karma of that is coming in. And that's called your Sanchit Karam, your collected karam from so many lives. And every single Mahapurukh you talk to will explain to you the same thing, that you've got so much karma from previous lives called Sanchit Karam. And added to that, you've got the karma you're earning here, which is Kireman Karam. And you've also chosen from that massive pool of karma that you've got waiting for you, you've also chosen a certain amount of karam that in this life you're going to try and get through. Okay? And that's called your Pallabhat Karam, so like your destiny for this life. And there's many sakhiya that talk about the way that you can actually burn your karam. So the idea of, like in Kirtan Soila in the Nihang Singh Gurka, Maharaj talks about that. Ko dukhyam anakhatyam janam dardyam mahabikhadyam mitan sagar simarthar naam nanak jaise pavak pasmang jaise pavak. They say that you can burn all your karam just like fire burns wood. And they're saying that kor duking anakhatyam, you could have committed loads and loads of murders. Most people are not murderers. But in all of our lives, if you add up the amount of murders we must have done in our previous lives, then yes, you can say that we've got a lot of karma to get to deal with. Now when it comes to hell, firstly, this has got a link to the idea that there is a Taram Raj and there is a judgment. Yeah. So now, how do we know Taram Raj exists? So in Gurbani, just to quickly go through it, there's two places where Taram Raj is quoted as speaking. Yeah. This, people might be surprised to hear this, but Guru Sahib has quoted what Taram Raj said in two places. Many, probably other places, but there's two that I can talk about straight away. The first one is again in Kirtan Soila, in the Rakhyande Shabad part that people read. And in there it says, जह साधु गोविंद भजन कीर्तन नानक नीत ना हो ना तू न छुटे निकट ना जाइयो दूत. द हिस्ट्री ऑफ दैट इज देयर वाज अ पर्सन हु वाजंट दैट गुड अ पर्सन एंड व्हेन ही वाज ग्रैब्ड एंड ही डाइड ही वाज टेकन बाय द जमदूत्स एंड ही वाज गोना गेट टेकन टू हेल बट ऑन द वे दे लुक्ड एट हिज लेखा एंड दे रियलाइज्ड दैट ही once in his life he sat down with somebody who was a holy person and had said God's name. So therefore he was given some time in heaven, and then he was going to get taken out and put into hell where he was going to go. Now what happens next is that he stays in Sachkhand and doesn't come back out. He stays there, and the Jamdoots are annoyed because they can't go inside and grab him and bring him out. So they go to Taramraj or Jamraj, and they ask him for permission to go inside and get him. And that's when he says, Jai Sadhu Gobind Pajan Kirtan Nanak Neet Na Ho Na Tu Na Shute Nikat Na Jayu Dut. The translation is, where the saints are singing God's praises, yeah, and they're singing Kirtan of God every day, I can't go there, you can't go there, and the Dutes can't go there. Any Dutes can't go there. Now, why would, if Guruji was quoting themselves, then Guru is basically saying to a Sikh that wherever this Kirtan is going on, I can't go there and you can't go there. That makes no sense. Guru Sahib is there in all the Kirtan, and the Sikhs can go to all Kirtan. So this is a quote given from Tadmaraj. Now the second quote I can give you is, there was a guy, without going on too into the deep history of this, there was a guy who was ascetic, you know, somebody who used to do a lot of penance. But he wasn't a very big fan of Guru Amar Das Ji. He used to curse them, he used to swear at them, he was a bit of a thorn in their side, in living within the town of Goindwal Sahib, where Guru Sahib was. Now what happened is that once he dies, okay, Guru Ram Das Ji Maharaj talks about what happens to him when he goes to in front of Jamdoot. Now as they actually quote what Jamdoot is saying to his people. So this tapa, his name is Tapa, his sort of nickname given there in Bani is a Tapa. And you can find a Shabad in Gurbani. And basically Guru Ram Das Ji Maharaj is a Shabadam. And they're saying that Taramrai, so they say his name, Taramrai, Jamkankaranu, that Jamkankar are the his agents, okay, his minions, as you might say. Taramrai, Jamkankaranu Aak Chhadiya. The Taramrai said to the Jamkankars, what did he say? Es Tape no, Tithe khad paiyo, jithe maha maha hathyarya. Put this tapa in the place where we put the biggest murderers. Because why? Because he's done nindya of the great beings like Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj in this world. So he gets put into this worst hell that you would put all the murderers. You might, you know, this person asks the question, say, why do you take this literally? Maybe it's poetry. That Shabad is actually not in a lot of poetry. Guru Ram Das Ji Maharaj, although, are an expert poet, and their poetry is so beautiful, their Gurbani is so beautiful, but sometimes they write things that don't really rhyme. And this one doesn't rhyme that much. It does rhyme at the end, but it's not really, the structure is not so much poetic. Now, at the end of this Shabad, Guru Ram Das Ji Maharaj, they say something very interesting, which might help this person to ask a question about being literal. They say, Har ke dar vartya, so Nanak aak sunaya. They say, this is all that is happening in God's court, and Nanak is just telling you and making it heard to you what is happening in God's court. So Guru Ram Das Ji is watching this happening, and they're quoting, yeah, what Jam Taramraj said to the Taramrai, to the Jamdoots, and they're saying, this is all that's happening, I'm just telling you about it. So I don't think that anybody who sits there thinking, oh, don't take it literally. But Guru Ram Das Ji is not, he's just telling you. He hasn't said a joke afterwards. You know, I was just joking with you. It wasn't real. They've been very clear about what they're saying. So for me, you know, the Gurbani, okay, the quotes of Taramraj, the idea of Narak, Nanga do jag chalya, tan disse khara daravana, kar ogan pachotavana. As from Asadiva Maharaj says, you'll be naked and dragged into hell, and then you'll be regretting it. So you'll always regret doing bad actions. I mean, what is unliteral about that? And if you say, oh, well, you know, Is the Christian concept of heaven and hell, we don't have it in Sikkim. I don't think that that's a very very logical way to look at Sikkim. We don't have to define Sikkim by what other religions are saying. Oh, we can't have this because that's in Christianity. We can't have this because it's in Islam. We can't have this because it's in the Hindu text. That is not a logical way, okay, for a Sikh to define Sikkim. What we should define Sikkim by is what is the Guru saying. If Guru Sahib says this is true, it's true. And it's irrelevant if anybody else has it. We've got to have the confidence inside us to say, you know what, my Guru is telling the truth. And it doesn't matter what anybody else thinks. It doesn't matter whether it matches with somebody or doesn't match with somebody. It's just 100% the truth. And therefore, if the truth exists in other religions, great for them. We're not going to follow them. We're happy in our Guru. Our Guru is going to give us 100% the truth. So, I think I've covered that. The question was, why do I pick one concept over the other? Actually, you haven't picked any concepts. I've accepted death, I accepted heaven and hell, accepted reincarnation. Now, the question about Dasam Dwar, well, this is a very personal question, and why do I think that Dasam Dwar exists? Well, like, I think I've kind of mentioned this myself. Like, I feel my Dasam Dwar. I can feel it right here. And I talk about Gurbani. I start to feel the bliss there at the top. So, I mean, I can't really do much more than just say, yeah, I can feel it. You know, and other people. To be honest, for the last 4 years, I've been doing Prachar. Only people that don't feel their Dasam Dwar there have said to me, why do you think it's there? Everybody else has not really complained. So I've not had any letters of complaint from any of the Mahapuriks saying, why are you saying this? Or anybody who we know, that we hang out with Kathawachiks and people that are very learned. And no one's ever said to me, you shouldn't say that because that's not true. So me personally, I think that's fine to say Dasam Dwar is here. But remember, there are other spiritual centers and not everybody has to go through the same experience. So for example, we've got the Trikuti here. We've got the Hirda, the Kamal Parga, so we can have it here. So Guru Sahib is saying there's many places, you know, that non-manifests itself. Yeah, even in every room can start jumping now. So some people might feel it all over their body, other people might feel it in their heart, some people might feel it in their forehead, some people feeling it up here. But that's just a name for a place, that's all it is. So I don't think people should, if you haven't felt it, and you know, maybe, you know, either if you felt it somewhere else, that's cool, as long as you're feeling it. If you haven't felt it anywhere and you don't believe that there is an experience of God available, then I think you should go and do a bit more Bart and Bani and ask Guru Sahib and do Ardas. I mean, at the end of the day, sitting here saying good to Guruji, I know what you really meant to say, but every single person beforehand that came before me got it all wrong. I don't think that's the way to get Guru Sahib's blessings. I think it's better to say, I don't know anything. Tu samratha vada, meri mat thodi ram. I don't know anything. You're the greatest. You tell me where I should be feeling it. You bless me. You know, I think that's a better way. Humility and going to Guru Sahib. Next question, number 6. From your experience, how common is it that Sikhs leave the faith? I see a lot of people, material for people going from Sikhi to Islam. Most of it seems to be in the UK. What is the ground reality of the situation? I think the ground reality is far worse than anybody realizes, because very few people are involved in seeing the ground reality. You know, the two main groups, Sikh Youth, Birmingham, and also SAS in the UK, they're involved in this and they end up dealing with this. I get called sometimes from people saying, please come and talk to my daughter or my son. I think they might be at risk of converting. Most of the time, I think the parents are very ashamed and they don't want to talk about it. And so therefore, what happens is that these things don't get talked about. And so I would say it's probably worse than we know. It's also happening in India, by the way. I came across a guy in Bangalore who almost converted to Islam, but then came back into Sikhi. There are a lot of people in places like Jammu and Kashmir, a lot of Sikh girls I found out from our group in India who went up there to do some prachar, that actually in Jammu and Kashmir, there's a lot of grooming going on. So what you've got is either boys or girls that have been groomed, you know, and over many years from when they were young or they were vulnerable, into getting into relationships and then being converted as part of that relationship. Or you've got the kind of traditional conversion, which is, you know, you educate somebody until they decide to leave Sikhi and become Islam, but Muslim. But most of those people, to be honest, don't have a very good grasp of Sikhism, or they've got very bad role models. So the reality is actually worse. Yes, it's a lot more in the UK. But my view about that is it can all be solved through education. So we can solve all these problems through education. And that's what we're involved in. And I'm sure if we talk to people around the country, not people will tell us, but especially that guy in Bangalore, you know, he was going to go into Islam, but he just became a Sikh and kept his gish and became a Singh instead. And that was pretty much watching our anti-conversion series. So I don't think that we should be worried about this as we should put resources towards it. But if we invest in education, we can solve these problems. Question number seven. Do you believe a separate Sikh nation would be secular, like Ranjit Singh's, or based upon Sikh laws? If you go with Sikh laws, where would you drive them from? The Sri Guru Granth Sahib, the Sam Granth Sahib, the Raith Maryada? Well, I think if it's going to be a Sikh nation, then it will be based upon Sikh laws. But Sikh laws include respect for other people's religion. And so, therefore, the idea of a secular government is one that doesn't bring religion into it. But the thing is that Guru Sahib has given us many hukams that keep power, keep the army, and keep politics in the hands of the Khalsa. So even if you craft a religion, a country which is secular, but it still needs to be ruled by Sikhs, yeah? And the Sikh principles need to be applied. So where you've got either a Sikh school or a Sikh ethos school, I would say the government needs to be based upon Sikh ethos, which is to respect everybody, respect women. Yes, Ranjit Singh's kingdom was, respectful to all religions, but it was called the Sarkar e Khalsa. It was not called, just Ranjit Singh's kingdom. It was called the rule of the Khalsa. And so I think that's a fine way to do it, you know, to allow everyone to practice their religion and yet to be keeping everything on Sikh principles. Yes, I do think that we should have a separate Sikh nation, and those rules and the laws would come from Gurbani, from Hukamname, the Sikh Riyad Maryada, but also would come from the idea of respect for everybody. So dignity, compassion, the Sikh principles. So you've got compassion, justice, truth, contentment, you know, these kinds of things. So I certainly think, you know, things like, you know, just banning whatever Sikhs don't do would not be part of the Sikh nation. So if you think about nowadays, a lot of people will be thinking, well, a Sikh nation should ban all cigarette smoking. But it's part of some people's religion, it's part of their culture. So I think you can make allowances for people to practice their faith, as long as it doesn't impinge upon anybody else. Things like Guru Gobind Singh Ji's history, I've actually made videos about this, that, you know, we don't have laws against apostasy. So somebody could leave Sikhi while living in that nation. But at the same time, when Guru Gobind Singh's horse wouldn't go into the tobacco field, Guru Sahib just said, well, let's go out of the way and go elsewhere. But they didn't burn the tobacco field down. So live and let live, I think, is fundamentally part of the Sikh principles, as long as it's not harming anybody else. Number eight, thoughts on bringing basics of Sikhi to the US. Haha. I don't think there's a haha in there. We're going to bring it there for sure if Guru Sahib allows it. We're now in Canada. Bhai Harman Singh from Calgary has joined us full time and he's doing Prachar. He's been to the US already, to the Charity Kala camp in America. He's going across, I'm sure, pretty soon, sometime, somewhere else in America. So I come there, and Baljeet Singh, I'm sure, will go there as well. So we've been there. The reality is, all we need are people from there to basically come on, join us and become Pracharaks. And if they do that, then basics is now in the US. So with Guru Sahib's kirpa, you know, we will come there as well. So number nine, the Sikh Kaum and Khalsa Panth have been on a very tumultuous trajectory for the last century or so. One that can be attributed to the social, political circumstances in which Sikhs found themselves confined, but also the reaction of the Qaum itself. Nation must have institutions which can create a safe space to congregate, discuss and establish plans of actions. Our gurdwaras were initially meant to be those institutions, but they become buildings for matha take, weddings and a khandpath. As many Sikh youth wake up, we are realizing the need to take the Gurdwara back and turn them into institutions worthy of the ideals of the Khalsa Panth. This person admired the Dera Panth Vase for taking on the Gurdwara committees, although it was not successful in the short term, but it did raise. So the question is, how do we go about doing this? How do we go about getting the youth to start taking over Gurdwaras? The structures, committees and parties, incredibly complicated issues. A Gurdwara is done by committees, but how are committees elected? How are they seen by the civil structures? How do new groups enter the foray of Gurdwara politics? Well, you know, my experience of this is very simple. All you need in a normal Gurdwara to set up a separate committee is to get a copy of the constitution, read it, and then work out what it requires for someone to stand to be on the committee. The Gurdwara must give you a copy of the constitution. You can normally find it online as well. We found it quite easy by walking into the Gurdwara and asking for a copy of it. Now, when you've got a copy of it, what we found out here in Southall is that to stand against a Gurdwara committee, all you need to do is be a member of aforesaid Gurdwara committee for the last 3 years. So we had a problem because when Dera Panth Vase decided to set up a youth committee, the problem that happened was that most of the youth were not members. But that was 3 years ago. And a lot of people became members at that time. And now, when the next elections happen next year, they'll be eligible to stand for the Gurdwara committee. So we could only find 4 people last time to stand in Dera Panth Vase. But I'm sure this time, and I know that there's many, many more people that are lined up to stand inside the committee. And these are people of all ages, youth and elders, working together to create a committee that will be focused upon the ideals of education and Guru Sahib Seva and the Panth Seva. So it's not that complicated. I would say that Gurdwara committees are just as complicated as you... Oh, I have to move our hands, sorry. The lights will come back on. Okay, here we go. Sorry about that. The lights go on off in the office when we're not moving around, so I've got to gesture a bit more. So the question is, how do we do this? Get a hold of the constitution, work out how it works, and then set up your team based upon that. So you may have to have a long-term plan, like, okay, we can't do it now, let's all become members this time, and then wait 5 years. You may have to collect a whole bunch of money because over here it's not that expensive to become a committee member, but in some Gurdwaras it's like hundreds of pounds or hundreds of dollars or $1,000. So you may have to collect a whole bunch of money and then invest that into becoming members of the Gurdwara committee so that next time you can stand. So this is the way it works. Don't get too scared about this. Yeah, you know, most youth, like I set up my own business, that was scary. You know, I've got kids, that was scary. So all these things, okay, they're scary, but you learn to cope with them because they're not that hard. Because look at the people that are running the Gurdwara. Do we expect them to be geniuses? Are these guys like brain surgeons that are running the Gurdwara? Not really. If they can manage to work the system, you can manage to work the system, all right? So make it work for you. Okay. On the last question, the Panchayat Pyara system has often been pushed in terms of reforming the governing structure. How practical would that be? And how would Gurdwaras be answerable to the central authority of Sri Akal Takht Sahib? Let me deal with that first point, the second point, the central authority of Sri Akal Takht Sahib. Look, currently, Sri Akal Takht Sahib is being taken over by people that are against the Sikh Panth being an independent sovereign organization, yeah, or a nation. So, therefore, we have an occupied Akal Takht Sahib at the moment, yeah. The Gyani Gurbhajan Singh has already been, Basarwat Khalsa last year said, you're not our Jathedar anymore. And he's been kind of unselected. At the same time, if for a long time after that, he couldn't go anywhere because people were like shouting at him and swearing at him. And he was stuck basically in his position. So, and then when it comes to looking at the people that were elected by the Sarvat Khalsa, then there's many major questions there about how their names were elected and, you know, how did we put their names in? And was it just a political thing by Simranjit Singh Mann? So what we've got is we've become people that are in neither camp. I would say a lot of the youth, a lot of the people that I talk to, they can't say I'm 100% behind Sarvat Khalsa people because after that Sarbat Khalsa, you know, months, 2 months later, all the news started coming about what had happened. And people started thinking that wasn't right. Then also, we can't work with these current Jathedars that are taking over Akal Takht Sahib. So my view is, go back to what Guru Har Gobind Sahib did in Kiratpur Sahib. Okay? When they moved out of Akal Takht Sahib to Kiratpur Sahib, Guru Sahib actually set up a Gurdwara in Kiratpur Sahib, which is called Takht Sahib. That Gurdwara is a Takht Sahib. Later on, what you never see is Guru Gobind Ji never goes to Akal Takht Sahib. But the Panth is functioning fine because Guru Gobind Singh Ji is in charge. Okay, so that place, Akal Takht Sahib, is the only takht that the Guru made. But when the Guru made it and they weren't living there, they moved the takht. And then later on, you see reflections of this in the Nihang Singh. Buddha Dal calls themselves a Chakravarti Takht. That this is a roaming takht. Wherever the Buddha Dal sits, then that is the takht, the throne of the Khalsa. And you see reflections. When Massa Rangar was beheaded by Sukha Singh and Mehtab Singh, there was a Gurmata passed by the Khalsa Panth to go and do that. And you know, that Gurmata was not taken at Akal Takht Sahib because that was occupied. So we should have a similar viewpoint right now. That our Akal Takht Sahib isn't occupied. And we need to make a separate Akal Takht Sahib, a separate a government in exile, you might say, somewhere else. Okay, that is exactly what any army and any self-respecting nation would do. That if their main building has been captured by people that are against them, they will set up an alternative. I'm not saying that get rid of Akal Takht Sahib and don't think about that place. One day in the future, we'll take that back. But remember, Guru Gobind Singh Ji didn't go there. The Sikh Panth took it back later on. So we could, in the current moment, operate without trying to make everything subservient to Akal Takht Sahib and getting a rubber stamp by Gyani Gurbachan Singh sitting there in Amritsar. He is basically a granthi that was appointed to that as a political appointment. And we can't see him in the likes of Akali, Fula Singh and all the other people out there. So the question here is, how practical would the Panjabiari system be? And do they need to be answerable to the central Akal Takht Sahib? So firstly, we don't need right now to be answerable to them. We should set up a separate authority somewhere else. And I would say at the moment, you know, taking it out of India would be a good idea. You might say, well, most of the Panth is in India. But yeah, when it's in India, you can get arrested just for having a Sarbat Khalsa. So at the moment, probably it's better to have it in America or Canada or England or Germany, wherever it is, you know, you want to have it. I'm not the person to decide these things. Yeah, I'm not like, you know, chosen by anybody in the Panth to represent. And therein lies the problem. What we need are chosen representatives of our Panth, right? And if we're going to choose these people, how should we choose them? We have to choose them by the Sikh principles. We can't just pick them because they happen to be politically active. We've got to find people that have got the right thinking, people that are intelligent, people that are educated in Gurbani, maybe educated in multiple languages, people that are immersed in Naam. It's a key thing that we need to have in anybody. So Naam, Rehat, you know, people that are learning, are earning Sikhi every day. I think that's very practical. I can tell you that most of the Sangat at the moment that I meet in countries up and down, in Gurdwaras up and down the country and abroad, most of them don't turn around and think, yes, the Gurdwara Pradhan is somebody that I respect as a Gur Sikh and I'm going to follow what they say. They don't think that. They think, oh, businessman, yeah, give them a bit of cash, vote for them, they'll do what you want. And politicians at the moment in this country have the lowest respect, lowest percentage belief out of all organizations. So when you've got doctors, lawyers, everybody else, put them rank, all public officials, politicians come rock bottom. 15% of people would believe in them. And what we've got now is we've introduced the same flawed system into our Gurdwara. So I think this question is a strange question. How practical is it? Well, why don't we try first and then see that actually the people might respect the Panjabiari a lot more than they respect, you know, the current politician-driven Gurdwara committee system. And we don't need to make them subservient to some authority in Punjab. Let's make a global authority for the Panth. Let's make one, base it somewhere, start locally, set up a Punjabiari for UK, set one up for Canada, set one up for America. Bring them all together, and then those people can be our global Sikh council or whatever you want to call it. But what I find really annoying, I was going to say it because there's many organizations out there that have set themselves up as a global voice for the Sikh Panth. I find it annoying that none of them be chosen by the Sangat at large and chosen for their good Sikh values. You know, every organization just put forward its five people and say, these are the people that are going to run this thing. Why don't they go through a Gurmata, bring together hundreds of thousands of people? Let's make a short list. I've talked about this on our videos. How do you pick Panjabiari? That first thing should be happening is you should put a short, but in certain, before you make a short list of people, you need to come up with the qualities that everybody agrees we need in our Jathedars. Then put forward names of people that are going to be fitting that criteria, and then let the Sangat, you know, give their views about who they want out of those people that they feel are the most Charbikara people, the best people to lead. And then put those five people together and offer them that this is the role, this is what it will require. We will all listen to you, because you can't give someone power or a position but no authority and no power. So the Sangat must take an oath following this selection process. Yeah, the vidhi vidwanje nyukti hogi, if the selection has been done, then the system should be the Sangat all now literally should matha take the Panjabiari and say that from now on we will listen to you, you are our Jathedars. If you don't give these people the respect, they're never going to want to take that position, take on the headache. Who wants a headache? I've got one right now and I don't want it. You know, I've got to drink some water. The point I'm trying to make is that, well, no one wants the headache of leading people who don't want to be led. So we have to show our willingness to lead, to be led by these people, and then the Panth will work, the system will work. Excuse me. Okay. So the next question. How do we make it that the Sri Akal Takht is truly a moderating, unifying entity in the Panth, free from the grasp of any government, a state, central or western? Well, I think that you got to think about the conception of it. If you can't base it in Punjab because of the political situation, then you have to figure out a way where it can exist abroad. Yeah, and you know, we've got now things like YouTube and Google Views, and people can give their views on certain topics online, and those can be incorporated into the Panth. And you could have a process that's a bit longer. Everybody uploads their views about these topics, and that's played in the Sangat, then people could act to take those views on board and make a central authority. So, you know, we could try and create a system that firstly is free from these people, and then I think that that would be unifying. But the thing here is that we've got to start at the country level. I think starting at a global level is just too big. You know, we don't know at the moment how to respect Jathedars. We don't know how at the moment how to follow people. What we've got is that, it's a bit of a funny English, it's an American saying actually, too many chiefs, not enough Indians. And that's the Panth at the moment. It's too many people that are trying to be leaders and not enough people that want to be followers. Pairokar hai gaini, saare log ki apne bane hoye ne ki asi raabar hai gaini. So in order for us to create followers, I think that at Gurdwara level and then at a national level, we should set up Panjathedars and start to follow them. And then when we've learned how to respect and follow the authority of the Panj, then we should put forward from each country our Panj to go into an international forum. These people will be experienced in leading the Sikh Panth. These people will be experienced in having to compromise, because believe you me, when you lead a diverse bunch of people, you have to learn to compromise. At the moment, most of our leaders, okay, or spokespeople, or you know, our pracharaks, they all come from different jathas. In a jatha, okay, compromise is not the way you go up the line. In a jatha, by being the most hardcore person in that jatha, you can go up the line. People respect those that are hardcore. Now the problem is that compromise is how you work at a panthic level. So it's not necessary all the time that the person who is heading each jatha is the best person to put forward into a panj. Because what might happen is that person has spent so many years being uncompromising and therefore going up the ladder, they might not know how to compromise anymore. Okay, so this is one of the kind of problems of the current jathebandi type system we've got. Now, let's say we did appoint the leaders of all the jathe, but when they have to sit together and they have to agree, because this is the thing that we have to remember, that the panj have to agree. Well, maybe in a couple of years, those people will learn how to compromise, or the people that couldn't compromise leave and somebody else who can work together with other people comes in. The point is that once we've learned how to work together, those people that are unifying, that are good, they are moderating, that are moderate in their views, they can then go forward into a global system, and that global system will then work. We're kind of like, at the moment, I would say that at a Pantic level, we're kind of like little kids, you know, like not even teenagers yet. You know, we're like 8, 9 years old, and we're trying to make a system for adults. We're nowhere near that level at the moment. And I see that from when I travel, when I talk to people about selecting Panjpyari, no one seems to have any enthusiasm for this concept. You know, no one seems to think, yes, this is what we got to do. You know who has enthusiasm for this concept? It's always the Munni and the non-Amritaris. They've got a lot of enthusiasm for this concept because they want leadership. And they don't see themselves as people that need, that are going to be able to put themselves forward anyway. So they're happy to be led, right? They want leadership. The people that are in organizations that kind of are leading somewhere, that involve some kind of leadership organization, they're the ones that are the most negative towards setting up a panjathedar system in a gurdwara or even a country. The reason why, they're always thinking, well, am I going to be in that? Or is my person going to be in that? Well, we have to compromise. Because remember now, they've all got a view. And their view, sometimes a lot of them are thinking about, how can I get my view to be the most prevalent view in the pant? And how can I stop those people that disagree with me from getting ahead? So unfortunately, at the moment, we're going to have to wait for a while and keep on talking about the panj system. We have to keep on plugging that as the best system, because this is the best system that's going to give us the solutions for the future. Sorry, going on then, number 12. Okay, so most of this forum, as in Reddit, the one we're talking to right now, take a very metaphorical approach to reincarnation, doesn't dwell in miracles. Personally, I see reincarnation to be purely metaphorical. I don't think that I agree with that in the slightest. I think that Gurbani is not trying to be metaphorical about reincarnation. It's very clear about it, and I've kind of gone through that already. So, Gurbani, I don't believe, accepts the Abrahamic viewpoint of the one life theory, specifically because it doesn't make any sense as per the laws of karma and karma. Now, well, we're not saying that we have the same concept of karma as the Hindu religion has. Because in the Hindu religion, there's multitude of views, yeah? And karma has been used, or misused, you might say, to keep people in different castes. So we're against the caste system. We believe we're all individuals that have our own karma. But it doesn't mean that we don't believe in the laws of karma. And the idea of, you've got collected karma, sanchit karma, you've got your present life, what you've come, your destiny for this life, your palabad karam, and then you've got your karma you're earning right now, kiriman karam. It doesn't mean we don't agree with that. But one thing that we all, every Sikh must agree upon, is that naam is the power that burns karam. Yeah? Of all the things out there that you can earn karam with, there's only one thing that can burn karam, that doesn't earn any more karam, and that's naam. And so Guru Sahib has given that system. So Guru's kirpa is naam. Yeah? Gur Prasad and naam are interchangeable. So if we earn the Guru's grace, and if we you know, we chant God's name, then yes, we're going to be able to have a different viewpoint from other religions, because those people aren't trying to earn the Guru's kirpa. And if the question carries on, it says, so in my opinion, the Gurus were using established theology and spinning it so it would match Gurmat. I don't think the Gurus would ever spin theology. What they didn't agree with, they just said so. So Guru Gobind Singh Ji is very clear. They say, kich pahan mein parmeshwar nahi. There's no stone in, there's no God in a stone, you know. Maharaj says, in Shabad Zare Pashahi, they say, kahere pahan pooj, but, you know, why do you worship? So not in Shabad Zare Pashahi, they say, कहां पयो जो अतहित चित कर बहुविद सिला पुजाई पांथ क्यों पाहन कह प्रसत कच्छ कर सिर ना पाई ऐसे अशुद्ध धूप दीप अर्पत है पाहन कछु ना कह है सो यू गिव ऑल दीस गिफ्ट्स टू दिस स्टोन द स्टोन डजंट ईट एनी ऑफ देम ता मैं कहां सिद्ध है रे जड़ तोहे कछु भर दे है व्हाट पावर हैज दिस स्टोन गॉट दैट इट विल गिव यू समथिंग सो गुरु साहब व्हेन दे सी समथिंग दे डोंट अग्री विद They just criticize it straight out, you know. Tirith nava, je tis pava, vin paane, ke nai kari. They say, what is the point of taking this bath at a tirith if it doesn't please God? And that's why they say, tirith navan jao, tirith naam hai, tirith shabha vichar, antar gyan hai. So, I don't think the guru ever spins other people's theology to match gurmat. So, shabads like bahut janam bichre the madho, for them, they talk about how minds are constantly dying and fall into panch jor and become alive when we contemplate on Naam. What would my view on that be? I would say that's a very strange view to take based upon Gurbani. Because anybody who says, well, your mind dies and then gets reborn when you jap Naam, and that's what reincarnation is about. How does that explain all the things I've been talking about with Taram Raj and Jamduds and Manmukhano, Fir Janam Hai, Nanak Har Pai, yeah, God's will is that people that are gonna fail in this are gonna, you know, I don't understand what this person, it's kind of like somebody, I feel, you know what I feel? I feel like people who have grown up in a country which is majoritarily Christian or Muslim, okay, where the common person out there doesn't see reincarnation as very logical, they think it's a bit strange, that they've somehow managed to get some kind of inferiority complex about this because people laughed at them. And they've kind of in their mind thought, well, wouldn't it be good if it was just metaphorical? And, you know, it wasn't really talking about that. Well, even if Christians don't understand reincarnation, yeah, it's kind of irrelevant to us. We believe what the Guru's telling us. Don't care what other people say out there. We've only got the Guru. In fact, Guru Nanak Dev Ji says that Jo to prem khelna ka chao, sir tal tali, gali meri aao, it marg pair tarije, sir dije, kaan na kije. Kaan means to listen to other people. When we give our head to our Guru, we don't listen to anybody else. So, my view on that is that no, the mind is not constantly dying, because then Maharaj would say that in Gurbani. They would say that really there's no such thing as reincarnation. But there's no panktis. You know, out of 1430 angs, if there's no one pankti that says that reincarnation is not true, where are we getting this from? Now, for me, the question says is, you know, the next question, number 13 is it okay for us to start calling those people that don't have different views, you know, enemies of the panth? Because he feels that people would be seen who don't agree with the Guru's words and that they are enemies of the panth. Okay, even though that most of them align themselves with Sikhrat, Mirada, Guru Granth Sahib Ji, Nitnem, how do we prevent bickering and hate between Sikhs? Some people are, you know, fighting over certain things. Okay, let me just go through this, right? So, I don't hate someone who doubts whether reincarnation is true or not. And nor do I hate someone who doesn't believe in reincarnation, because Maharaj told us believe nirpo and nirvair. Okay? And nor should anybody else, because really it's like physics, you know. We're in the laws of physics, whether we like them or not. Someone could say to you, look mate, I don't believe that if I jump out the window, that I'm not going to fall and hit the ground. You could say, I think that's probably going to happen, mate. You know, I don't think you should jump out the window. And they say, all right, I won't jump out the window. All right, so well, then now you're both... no one's died, yeah, but you're both living. They just one person believes they could fly, other person believes you're not going to fly. Yeah. So in the same way, if someone doesn't believe in reincarnation, okay, but they follow Sikhi, they're doing the Nitnem, they're doing Simran, and you know this person, they believe in the Sikhrat Maryada, everything else, etc. So you don't have to fight with them. Yeah. Only problem comes is when that person goes around preaching that to other people. So if you're going to preach something, and this is the problem that I find with this thread, which is one of the reasons why, you know, this AMA is taking so long. I'm just being honest, you know, I found it a bit annoying that people were posting their views about something But where do they get the justification from? No one so far, okay, on this thread or anywhere on Reddit that I've seen, has given me Gurbani, which backs up their view that Guru Sahib is not being literal about this. They just seem to not give a Gurbani-based answer. And as I said in the video we just released recently, where do we get our Sikhi from? A lot of people are getting their Sikhi just from what they think or what they were told by their parents, or, you know, some guy who's traveling the world and preaching some radical new theory. You know, I heard there was a guy, I went to Yuba City, and this guy had come from another part of America, and he'd gone there for a month and he'd preached that there was no reincarnation. I watched a video of him on YouTube. His name is Veer Bhupinder Singh. And he was going around telling people there's no such thing as reincarnation. And you know what I found after talking to these people for such a long time? I asked them, I said, listen, if every single Mahapurukh in our history has agreed with reincarnation, every single respected Pracharak in our Panth has accepted reincarnation, who is this one person who I've never heard, or other people like the missionary, who are they to go around saying there isn't one? And do you not have a little bit of fear in you that, you know, you might be going against the Guru? And they were like, good point. But the problem with this view is this. Let me just explain to you how the mind works. Yeah, that's how I view it. There is something very, very seductive about coming up with a brand new theory that no one has come up with before. Yeah. And the seductive point is this. Yeah, you want to be different to your parents. You want to be different to what you've been told before. We want to innovate. And sometimes we can take that too far and start innovating in Sikhi, in the sense that we start to think we can change Gurbani, or change, or Gurbani is not really saying that, that I figured out something else, is not really saying this. And that's, I think that's very dangerous. Yeah, if we're going to innovate, it must be based upon Gurmat, it must be based upon Gurbani. And you know, this person, to be honest, hasn't given me any Gurbani for me to believe what they're saying. So would I see them as a Panth Dokhi? Would I see them as an enemy of the Panth? No. But if they start preaching this and they go on traveling the world, going around telling people that, you know, you shouldn't believe in reincarnation, you should start, this is not logical, Guru Sahib is just, I would say, then they're stepping into the realms of becoming an enemy of the Panth, because what they are doing, okay, is breaking other people's faith in the word of the Guru. That they're saying, oh, the Guru's not really serious about this, this is just a metaphor. Okay. If you've decided that this bit is a metaphor, then what about later on when it says that naam bina sab duniya chhat, that without naam, everything is dust. Maybe that's a metaphor as well. And maybe naam is not that important. Maybe it's just okay to be a good person. And maybe we can just make our own sikhi. Maybe we don't have to do Amrit Vela. Maybe we don't have to do our nitni. Maybe that was a metaphor as well. What's the need? What's the need to sit on the floor and do your part? Want to just sit on a chair or a sofa? It's more comfortable, you know? What is the need to cover your head, show us a ritual? And where will you draw the line? Where will you say, hold on, we've ended up in a church situation, everybody's sitting in the Gurdwara with tables and chairs, okay, and Guru Granth Sahib Ji is, everybody's sitting in shoes, because it was all metaphors. When will we draw that line? I think that the simplest way is not to go down that route whatsoever. Slippery slope. Sikhi, I think, is very young. Yeah, Guru Gobind Singh Ji, just 308 years ago, they gave Guru the Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj. We don't need to innovate as much as we need to just take on Gurbani, yeah, implement Gurbani in our lives and in our Gurdwara. In terms of how can we work together, understanding each other, and not being ritualistic. I think those things I've already talked about quite a lot, that there's some things that we don't need to argue about, things like Ragmala, meat, etc. These are issues, I believe, that at the current moment, the Panth can't deal with. We haven't even got Panjathadars. We're facing a desert in Punjab. We're facing drug alcohol crisis epidemic in Punjab, cancer epidemic in Punjab. We've got grooming and lack of education all across the West. This is not the time for us to argue about these issues. We've got no structure to even solve these problems. So in my view, first thing is to set up a structure. The other thing is to, deal with our issues, the most pressing issues, that are facing us right now in terms of the drug epidemic, the lack of education, cancer, etc. And then, okay, and farmer suicide. And then, you know, in the future, we can sort of come back and deal with these issues. The next question, number 14. Why do we feel the need to define Sikhi by other religions? Let's take reincarnation. We always feel the need to say we believe in reincarnation because of all the religions have some concept of the afterlife. Why can't it be that Sikhi doesn't care about the afterlife, whether or not it exists? The sansari vismad. So as it is in life that we find experience Waheguru, why can't we say we don't feel the need to care about what happens after death? Why do we feel the need to compare and contrast with others? Well, firstly, we don't need to be defining Sikhi with other religions. I kind of said that already quite clearly. But Gurbani is talking about the next world. Aage sukh mere mita. Yeah? Gurbani is talking about ki eh lok sukhi hai, par lok suhele. Gurbani is talking about Begumpura, a place where no one dies. Amarpuri, Guru Gobind Singh Ji mentioned the Hukamnama that if you do this. So Gurbani is talking about mukti, that if you do this, you can get mukti. You can go on to the next world. It's talking about the next world. So if it's talking about it, why can't we talk and discuss it? We don't need to say, we don't know. We don't understand. Like Sarabjit Singh Tundar recently, he was asked, what do you think about the next world? And he said, I've never been there. All right, you've never been there. But Gurbani's talking about it. Okay. I've never been to Africa, but I've seen pictures and I've seen texts and I've read articles and I can talk about Africa. As a Pracharak, there may be millions of things I've never talked about that I've never seen, but I may have to address them and talk about them. Doesn't mean I'm saying I'm an expert in them, but I can talk about Gurbani that talks about this. So we don't need to define Sikhi violence, but when someone asks you, we have an afterlife, do you have an afterlife? We can say, yes, Gurbani talks about an afterlife. But it's different from your afterlife. Especially, okay, I think that's quite key. Our afterlife of singing Simran and being in the presence of God, okay, is very different from the Islamic afterlife. Okay, a pleasure dome of, you know, living on a beach and having drinks and servants and huris to, you know, satisfy your every need. Surely, we should be explaining the contrast and also the comparisons. Because, you know, in an interfaith environment, comparisons are important because people can understand what concurs between each other and what the differences are. And I think there's nothing wrong with us doing comparing and contrasting, but we just need to define Sikhi by Gurbani and what the Guru said. And please, you know, in the same question that somebody said this, why can't it be that Sikhi doesn't care about the afterlife? You know, where is this question coming from? Are we telling the Guru, why do you have to talk about this, Guru Sahib? What is the need? Why can't you just leave it unsaid? I find that a little bit annoying, you know. Why do I find it annoying? Because the Sikh doesn't tell the Guru what to say. The Sikh listens. In Japji Sahib, it says, Sunae, four paudis, and then Manne, four paudis. It never has a paudi on Sunave. You're not here to make the Guru listen to you. You're here to listen to the Guru. So I think when people are doing this, it's a bit strange, really. Where do I see Sikhi growing? That's a nice question. And will it change like it did in the past? I'm not sure what they mean by that. Will it be a positive change or that a change that continues to dilute it? Do you see more Sikh organizations sprouting up in the future to challenge you, a threat, or do you welcome them? Well, that's a lot of questions. I see Sikhi going forwards. You know, I see more education taking place. I see more youth getting into Sikhi. I see, hopefully, people getting involved in that identity. I think we don't have to change Sikhi. We need to go back to Sikhi. You know, in that way, you know, the word there is fundamentalist. But I think that the fundamental Sikhi are beautiful. And it's like kind of, we're going to go back to what our Guru told us. I think that at the moment, we're a very uneducated gong. What I mean by that is most people have not read Guru Granth Sahib Ji. Most people have not read Dasam Granth Sahib Ji. Most people have not read Bhai Gurdas Siyawana. Most people have read Sudh Prakash or Panth Prakash or, you know, the Twari Gur Khalsa. No one has read very few people have read the Hukam Nami of the Gurus. There's different steeks that are out there, Amir Pandar, Fried Kotika, Sahibs. We are an uneducated gong. Most Gurdwaras don't have libraries going out there. There's no lectures about a complicated and advanced stuff. In an environment where we are like 6-7 year old kids and we've got PhD level books lying, the only thing we can do is invest in education. Yeah. And I think that's where I think we can go back to Sikhi, is educate ourselves so we go back to original Sikhi. Will it be a positive change? I think, I hope so. Anything that goes back to us, the Sikhi, sorry, anything that goes, takes us back to the Sikhi that Guruji gave us is going to be good. Pooran Sikhi. If more organizations come up in the future, is that a threat for us or do I welcome them? I welcome them. You know, I think it's great if more organizations come up. The thing with every organization that comes up is that they must try and do what they do best. Yeah, don't try and do everything. I mean, you might say, oh, you know, you're a bit like that. You're trying to do a Sikh PA, but and Prachar and everything. But we're sticking to, in a way, presenting Sikhi to the wider world, whether it's through the media, whether it's through the thing. And we see gaps and we see problems and we want to do something about them. And we try and find a project manager that can take over that project. We saw the translations weren't happening in the Panth. And so we said, okay, we appointed someone to work full time to go out there and translate all of our leaflets and videos into different languages. So we welcome, if some group comes up now in America and starts doing Prachar, like for example, you know, Vikram Singh Khalsa has set up a little group where they go around doing Kirtan, Gurvani, Vichar Jatha, I think they're called. Brilliant. You know, we actually said to them, why don't you work with us? Why don't we go? And he came to the, there was a camp. We filmed him. We put the videos on our YouTube channel. So we try and use that channel, our channel, as a kind of, a springboard and support other people. Like, for example, we made videos about what Khalsa Aid are doing. We've made videos. We promoted every organized Sikh youth. Birmingham did a talk about grooming. We're going to put that up. So we work with everyone. And I think that you only see it as a threat to you if you're trying to make your name as opposed to the Guru's name. And Guru Sahib saying, koi naam na jaane mera. And in fact, you know, when Basic started and all this kind of stuff, many people don't know my name, you know, even now. They haven't watched some videos. And if they haven't come to certain places where my name is written down, then they might not even know my name. And everywhere I go, people say, oh, you're Mr. Basic Sikhi. I think that's good enough. That's good enough. I don't need a name. And I think that is the right mentality for us to keep. The next question is, how do you feel about Sikh mercenary groups that uphold the ethics kept and maintained by the Sikhs in the Guru's period and Mr. period? Well, I've kind of said already that the original Sikhi is the best Sikhi. So I think that I would support any group that went and upheld the ethics kept and maintained by the Sikhs from the Guru's period. Yeah, and we've made videos about this. There's a Boko Haram video that talks about that we should go. Jazz, please. There's a video about the Boko Haram that said that we should set up a Sikh mercenary group, a private military company. It's a perfectly legal organization to set up. So we should try and set up a. We should try and set up a Sikh group, like a private military company, and go out there and actually take part in missions that are more in line with what the Guru has given us to do. Gurbani says, Tan jiyo teh ko jag mein, mukh te har chit mein judh bichare. Maharaj says, blessed is a person in this world that says Waheguru with their mouth and their mind is thinking about war. So, when you say mercenary group, remember, a private military company is a registered company, but that is taking part in military actions when they're invited in by a government. So that is what I think is important. You've mentioned the importance of itihas to interpret Gurbani and Rehat, yes. But there are numerous instances historically where we had practices that would be considered against Gurmat. Should we, as a Panth, look back to an ideal past to know how to conduct ourselves, or is our ideal state always somewhere in the future? Well, I think the gurus are the best judges of what Sikhi should be. In any post-guru period, okay, there will be people that were charitable and did the right thing, and there will be other people that didn't do the right thing. Even in the guru's time, there were people that were doing the right thing and people that were doing the wrong thing. So I don't think that we should basically think that in some part, apart from what the Guru said, we're going to find the perfect Sikhi. Yeah. So in the future, Well, I think that personally we should set up the structures that allow us to cope with the future and plan for the future. If you go, you know, I've made this point a few times before. Go up to any Sikh community leader. And there's two questions you can ask them that you can work out if this person is forward-thinking and somebody that we can respect for the long term. The first question is, please can you tell me all the problems that are facing our panth? So they could tell you, oh, you know, we've got farmer suicides, we've got Punjab problems, we've got education, Gurdwara committees, etc. They might not list them, but let's just see what they come up with, the whole list, right? Be of Guru Granth Sahib Ji and drugs or cancer, whatever. They come up with all of them. Now, the second question you ask them is this, what are you doing about them? And if they say nothing, at that point, you know, there's no need for you to deal with this person anymore. They're not a leader. They're just someone trying to gather votes to stay in charge. So for me, the future is always something that we strive to make better as per Gurbani. So we're never going to go, okay, that's enough. You know, we fed 6 million people a day now in Langar. You know, every day we apparently, doing our research for Langar Week, we found out that every day we feed 6 million people a day. So at that point we think, oh, you know what, that's enough now. No. We don't think that's enough. Yeah, we always got to be thinking towards the future. How can we do more seva of people? How can we bring more righteousness to the world? So there's never really an end to this. Yeah, how can we do more bhakti ourselves? So there's no ideal state in the past. There's still work to be done. Can non-Sikhs achieve mukti by japing naam and living in a good place? If that's possible, then why does a Sikh have to pursue Amrit and the strict rehat comes with it versus convert to Christianity and doing Naam Simran every morning? Here's why, yeah? If you decide to go for Christianity, okay, how do you know that what you're reading is pure from any error? Because the Bible wasn't written by Christ, okay, and I don't know why he didn't write one. If he felt that it was so important to write down things, you know, in the 3 years, we've done a lot of work to document and write stuff down. Why didn't he write it down? Same with Prophet Muhammad, you know, if you've got a prophet who's supposedly sending you the full truth and nothing but the whole 100% truth, then why didn't he compile the Quran in his 23 years? You know, 23 years he was around. Surely the question would be that couldn't he have learned how to read and write? And couldn't he have then compiled the Quran while he was around? Why did it have to be left to be done after his death? The gurus were literate. The gurus compiled Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj and they checked it and they marked it as pure. So for a Sikh, we're blessed because we're following Guru Granth Sahib Ji, which we can say with absolute certainty is the exact words of our guru. So we can take comfort in that. So somebody could say, oh, well, you know, Sikhi seems so hard, I'm just going to move away. But you can't fool God. You try to take a shortcut towards God because, you know, you found it a bit hard to keep your hair and everything else. But if you go into any dharam and you look at the ultimate thing for a Christian, well, it's to become a monk. And those that felt so compelled by Christianity left their houses, went and lived in the mountains and became monks and gave up everything. You know, so I think that life is actually harder than the castle life of living within the world, being married, having kids and having a job and yet keeping a Sikhi going. Buddhism, again, there's monks. That's the ideal, in a way, the Buddhist. So for me, I think Sikhi is very simple. It's very straightforward. And for me, I don't think we need to worry about saying to people, oh, you can get it in other religions. So people might just say, oh, I don't want to follow Sikhi. What we've got is so good. If you just tell it properly, people will buy it off you. You don't have to sell it. Just tell it. Yeah, and if we tell people about the gurus, they'll automatically fall in love with the gurus. We've got white people that have taken up Sikhi. We've got people that used to be Muslim that are coming up to us saying, I'm going to give up Islam and become a Sikh. We've met people of all types that have become Sikhs because they find the guru compelling. They find Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj, the Bani compelling. They find the experience of Sikhi very powerful and the guru's grace. That's enough. We don't have to worry about, you know, is it going to make it easy to leave Sikhi? At least teach it first and find out. So, How do I look so young? The dude is in his 30s now. I'm actually 37. I probably just look young because I wear t-shirts and jeans. That's probably the only reason. I've got quite a few in the last year because of all the stress of running basics and CPA and everything. I've actually aged a lot. So this daddy now, you know, I don't even see over here, but it's quite a few white hairs now, especially on my mucha and stuff. So, you know, I think Maharaj probably wanted me to look young because people thought, oh, it's a young guy and he's doing these videos. Isn't it so cute? Not realizing that I was like 34 and doing these videos. So maybe some of the 20-year-olds wouldn't have watched those videos in the beginning thinking, oh, this guy's like some old guy. You know, there's like 13-year-old kids that are watching our videos now. So maybe that was the plan. Is maybe that's what Maharaj wanted, but I don't know. I just, this is how I look. Is Dasam Granth Prakash on the same takht as Guru Granth Sahib Ji acceptable? Firstly, you know, there's a question, there's a problem with saying Dasam Granth Sahib Ji, although I know I say it all the time. Just gonna give me 1 second. Thank you. The reason that there's a problem in Dasam Granth Sahib Ji doesn't really mean anything. Dasam Granth means the 10th Granth, and it's not the 10th Granth. So the real name that you could say Dasam Guru Patshah Ki Granth or Dasam Patshah Ki Granth, the Granth of the 10th Guru. If it's in the same takht as Guru Granth Sahib Ji, is it acceptable? I say when the word acceptable, the opposite of acceptable is unacceptable. It seems very, you know, black and white. It's either acceptable, it's unacceptable. I'd say probably the better way would be preferable, and then, you know, okay and not so good. If we had three things, and this is what I would say the ideal, the preferable situation would be Guru Granth Sahib Ji at the highest, Dasam Granth Sahib Ji slightly lower, and if Sarvalok Granth Sahib Ji is there, then they can be at the same level as Dasam Granth Sahib Ji. So I think that would be the preferable ideal. And that's exactly what happens at Hazur Sahib. That's exactly what the Nihang Singhs do most of the time. Now, if for some reason, you know, we can't raise Guru Granth Sahib Ji a little bit, mostly people can, but if we can't, for whatever reason, I think it's not unacceptable to have Dasam Granth Sahib Ji at the same level as Guru Granth Sahib Ji, as long as you make it clear where Guru Granth Sahib Ji is and where Dasam Patshah Di Granth is. Because that way people can know that, but to be honest, we bow to both. Why would we bow to both? Because they're both in our nickname. They're both Amrit Baniya. You know, we're reading that Bani in our nickname. If you don't have Guru Granth Sahib Ji with you, then what's going to happen is, in a house, is you would bow to a Gutka. That's what I would do, bow to a Gutka if I didn't have Guru Granth Sahib Ji. And that's what I do. Now, in my Gutka, yeah, as nearly everybody's Sundar Gutka, whatever Gutka, there is going to be Guru Granth Sahib Ji's Bani and Dasam Granth Sahib Ji's Bani, right? So, you're bowing to it, it's the Guru. Are you going to put Jab Sahib in the bin and then keep Jabji Sahib not in the bin? No, it's Amrit Bani, because it makes Amrit, so it must have Amrit inside it. So, for me, it's just the case that it's the Guru's Bani. We treat it with the same respect. Now, according to Akal Takht, Hukum Nama, it says Dasam Granth Sahib is not the same, should not be prakashed at the same level, but some people are doing it. Is this good? As I said to you, it's preferable if it's higher. If for some reason, or maybe just by a being unaware of this and also of what Nihang Singhs do, people do it at the same level. It's not like a massive crime is being committed, you know. We don't have to get so angry. We can just go and educate someone with love and say, look, we understand that you want Dasam Granth Sahib Pas, Dasam Patshah Di Granth to be in Prakash. That's cool. Can we just put like maybe a little couple of, you know, slats of wood underneath the Palki Sahib, raise it up a little bit more for Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj, so that it can be clear that Guru Patshah, they gave supremacy to Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj. And I think that's fine. But, you know, this is something we can do better with pyar and love than we can with sorry to get angry. Just read this question. Yeah, this person said, oh, basically he's manmat to put it at the same level. And I don't think that is harsh to say it's manmat. It might be, you know, it's like how many fingers are we gonna have to point? You know, and if you start pointing fingers here, there, 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 I tell you what, you're gonna run out of fingers very quickly, and there still be loads of things to point at. So I think in this case, you know, the pendulum that swings too far on one side, where no one's reading the Samgran Sahib Ji, no one's understanding that Bani, for it to swing back to the middle, to a good steady state, it's probably going to swing this way a bit more in the beginning. And that's where I think that at the moment we're going to, is people are so upset about how little respect is being given to Samgran Sahib Ji, they're going to probably for a while continue doing programs which kind of go a bit extreme on promoting the Samgran Sahib Ji. But that's going to probably be needed in order to raise the awareness that is required so we can come back to a steady state in the middle where everybody respects and understands the Samgran Sahib Ji. How did I get into Sikhi? That video is already on our YouTube channel. To cut a long story short, I met a bunch of Gursikhs. I didn't meet any Gursikhs before. I read a few books about New Age religion. They told me, well, that's already in Guru Granth Sahib Ji. I sat down and did some Simran. Simran blew my mind. I went to a Sikhi camp. Sikhi camp blew my mind. Loads of learning, loads of Simran, loads of Sangat. And I thought, I got to sell my mind to my Guru. I'm sold. And I took Amrit and sold my mind to Guru. I remember you saying in a video a long time ago that Guru Gobind Singh Ji burnt the masands as punishment. This story originates from Panth Prakash Ratan Singh Pangu. It kind of treats him like a contemporary missile lord, a king, hyperly masculine emperor. Do you believe that Guruji, but they didn't burn them in the sense that would burn men alive. From what I understand on that, these people were masands that had been accused by the Sangat. The masands was a good, originally a good name. It meant people that were given as representatives of the Guru. But these people were actually doing really bad stuff. They were stealing from the Panth. They were, you know, molesting women and doing loads of things like that. So, basically, do I believe that Guruji would do it? Yeah, I do believe that the worst crime in Sikhi is to steal from the Guru's Golak. That Guruji did that as a serious punishment, and also as a way to teach us that there are times with capital punishment. One of the very few times of capital punishment is ordered by the Guru. And that basically is about, you know, because of what they did. could it be justified to hurt others in a similar manner? Well, I don't think that we can be thinking, oh, I know, we should just burn him like the Guru did. Well, in this country, in this world, no, we can just move him out of power just by winning the elections. So there's no need to go down that route. There's many depictions of the Guru in different grants. Do you think it is, Bhaji, to be honest? Yeah, this question, being quite deep, and I'm not trying to say that, you know, I can't take a deep question, but remember, there needs to be some kind of Gurmat council that we need in our panth, where, you know, Bhai Veer Singh Ji, he did this job for a lot of people. He went and sat down and he went through many grunts and he sort of edited them based upon his view of Gurmat, and they're quite good, you know. But ideally, what we need is a Guni Gyani Behemata Pakaya. You know, Guni Gyani people that have a lot of qualities, people that have got a lot of knowledge, to sit down together and decide upon certain things that they are in our panth. And this can be something you can put forward to people like that. Me as one individual, my view, I think, is kind of irrelevant, really, you know, on this or something like this. Why do you think so many Amritaris and Gursikh families still marry along caste lines? Because, believe it or not, most Amritaris are from Punjabi background. And that's why they do this, because they're still stuck in Punjabiism. Even though they want to leave that and get into Gursikhi, the families are still very much conflating Sikhi with Punjabism, and so they worry about their what people will say. They worry about the culture clash, because there are small culture differences, but it's not big anymore as the children are growing up in the Western world. I think it's just the fact that we're not Niyara, and that's why we haven't got the guru support at the moment. You know, if you look at the Panth and the trouble it's going through, it's kind of like you can see that guru is not really supporting us right now, because we're not staying in Niyara. We're not being unique and true to what he had said. So I think that every single time people go against the guru as Amritaris, we actually have we cause damage to ourselves, but we cause damage to the Panth as well, because one more way the Panth can come down is that every single individual in the Panth is not working to build it up. So acting in the right way is actually a Panthic seva, if you think about it in that sense. What are the top five basics of the Sikh faith which we can strive to lead our lives? Based on which we should strive to lead our lives. Sat, truth, santokh, contentment, daya, compassion, dharm, righteousness, and khima, forgiveness. These are the five main qualities that if we can bring into our lives. And when it comes to sat, you can include in there nimrata. Because the truth is, Akal Purakh is the greatest, and we're nothing compared to Akal Purakh. So those things, those five qualities are the best qualities to bring into your life. I have gone from an anti-Khalistan stand to a pro-Khalistan stand. Why is that so? Actually, I haven't gone from anti to pro. All I said in the beginning is that I don't know about the size of Khalistan. I've always been pro-Khalistan in the sense I always believe the Sikh Panth should have its own freedom and should be in charge of its own destiny. The only problem is how big a land should we aspire to take over. And, you know, I always, when I look at Punjab, the current Punjab, I do feel it's a bit small. You know, I do feel that a lot of people in Haryana and Himachal that are Sikh, and maybe it should be bigger. And I thought, okay, well, should it be bigger and include Himachal and Haryana? And I thought, hold on. You know, for the last 50, 60 years, 60 years really, we've been oppressed, suppressed, murdered, raped, butchered in India because we were so small. So what about now payback? Now, it's not revenge, but it's like, how do you ensure that doesn't happen to you again? For me, it was like, well, I just expand out and take over the whole country. So that's always been my view, and I still say that it'd be better for us to just aim to take over India and actually trying to wrestle a small bit of land away from a powerful power is harder than actually working in the long term to displace that power, take it over, and then you've got everything they had. So that's my view. Now, people are questioning whether I'm going against the 1986 Sarbat Khalsa resolution, which was to set up a Khalistan. And I felt that it was worthwhile to say that I'm not against the Panthic view. It's just that my long-term view is different. Yeah, and I think that's fine. Everybody in the Panth can have a long-term view, which is different. But it doesn't mean that we think it's okay to then go against the Panthic view. You know? Where is the sourcing for your claim that Guru Nanak Dev Ji knew Shastra Vidya in your Vaheguru course? This is basically based upon people that I have met who are very learned, who told me this. We've got this Sina Basina tradition, the Sikh Panth. So something that I made up, that, you know, you learned from someone and they passed it from their Sina, their Chati, to your Chati, because they taught you, you know, face to face, and they taught you to stuff. So this is where I got it from. It's not really from some. I'm sure that if we look into the different grants, there will probably be actual source for this. So I can't give you that right now. Apparently, according to this person, I have selectively chosen some things literally and other things not literally. That, for example, I believe that we're made from the five tats. Apparently this person says that I don't believe that we're made from the five elements, but I do believe in a literal lesson. Why do I choose which one? No, I've never said that we're not made from the union of the five elements. Gurbani is saying it, I believe it to be true. But I just don't understand it yet. Yeah, I don't understand. But if you look at like the earth element, the tarti, the tarti has got all the different nutrients and the different chemicals that exist in the world. And we've got water. And when you say Agni, you can understand that we are combustible and there is a latent energy inside every single cell. And that could be the energy that can turn into fire, right? Because I'm not very good at this. I've forgotten the science at the moment. But there's potential energy and then there's realizing. So I think when Gurbani is saying that inside you, there is fire that can be the energy that exists inside you. And then there's air inside us, obviously. Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to breathe. Oxygen floating through all of our lungs and everything else and our veins. So I don't think I've actually gone against and said we're not based on the Panchtatvas. I think we are. And also that I do believe in the Tadasam Dwar. So there you go. Next question. Oh, if the answer is Itihas, then previous people doing something isn't a reason, this person says. No, it's not. It's based upon Gurbani that actually there is a literal Dasam Dwar because Gurbani is saying that. Okay? Nau Dware Pargat Ki Dasam Gupta Khaya. If Guru Sahib is saying that you've got nine visible doors, the tenth one is Gupt, for me, the fact that I can feel it, and secondly, other people I know can feel it there, and the third thing that I know that literally people like me who are walking around right now, they feel it in the same place. And the third thing is that when we look at... it's a bit late now, it's been a while, I've been talking on this thing, so it's a bit harsh. So then my point was, Gurbani, I can feel it, the people around me, I can link it to them. And the third one was so you've got these nine holes and they give you a good idea of that the tenth one is a literal place because nine of them are literal places, yeah? So therefore the tenth one is likely to be a place. And voila, you know, I feel it in the drop of the head. And every Mahapurukh kind of says it's up there. I felt it to be there. Other people have felt it. And so I can just say, well, I think that's what it is. So everybody has, at least, I mean, I think everybody has to have a view. I might be wrong about it. That's fine. But at least I've got a view that's based upon sound, logical reasons, you know. Do I remember Bina Kaur and Gur Meher Singh? Yes, I do remember them. And they're very nice people. I like them as well. All your content is amazing. That's number 28. And I especially appreciate the way this demystifies myths around Sikhi and focus on Sikhi's practical nature. I really like the last video, Sikhi versus modern values. Thank you so much. I'd like to ask you what your observations are on the state of the Panth today. And if anything you feel needs to happen to Sikhi to continue to be open and inviting to all people. You can't be open and inviting to all people without inviting them in. Can you understand that? Like it's built into the sentence. If you want to be an open and inviting community, the best way to do that is to have a big sign outside your Gurdwara saying, we are open and you are welcome to come in. And I always wonder about this. Why is there never a sign outside Gurdwara saying, you're welcome to come inside. We're open. Come on in. And maybe it's because we don't realize that what open and inviting really means. So that's what I think we should do. Bring Sikhi into Gurdwara, okay? And then open and invite people in. And literally put up a sign outside, big sign saying, come on in. What we could also do to see more open inviting is as people drive past our Gurdwara, why don't we put up a nice big quote of what Gurbani is saying? So, you know, if you change that sign every week, in a year, somebody's driving past the Gurdwara every day on the way to commute to work or whatever, they're going to see 52 quotes of Gurbani. And one of them might sit in their heart and they might like it And then they see the sign that says, we're open, you're welcome to come and visit anything. I want to come and find out more about these guys. And voila, everybody knows what you think. And people will be will feel that you are open and inviting. Next question. So the question was, in the video that I talked about why I went to Solstice, you said you liked some of the things about the 3HO. Amongst those, you listed belief in reincarnation, absolutely, miracles of people's spiritual lives, and Dharmaraj as one of their redeeming qualities. The people that don't believe in this are cutting at the real roots of Sikhi. A lot of people, this is a very similar question that came up earlier. Some people are going, in this Reddit especially, don't believe in this stuff. They're still Sikh. Can you, they're trying to work and defend Sikhi. They're trying to do good stuff. But when you say that these people don't care about Sikhi, this person feels that it's quite harsh. And would I and basically be willing to work with these people, even though we strongly disagree on some things? Well, let's just say that if someone was not believing in reincarnation, and that was the prachar they were doing, so if they were on a stage, I wouldn't want to sit in that stage or question them. If they're defending Sikhi from other people, that's fine. But on questions where the majority of the panth, or let's not say majority, the vast majority, like nearly everybody, is on this side, saying that we believe in literally reincarnation because we've got good, solid, Gurbani-based, evidence-based, you know, not evidence, but historical prachar and Mahapurukh-based views on this. And some people are saying, oh, no, it's just metaphorical. If the metaphorical people think they should be given an equal standing and the chance to preach that, no, I don't agree. I don't agree. Because that's going to, for me, why is it cutting at the roots of Sikhi? You're breaking people's faith in Gurbani that is not literal. And where will that line stop? I said it earlier. Secondly, give us some Bani that backs up what you're saying at least. And if you can't, then just say, I don't understand. I'll wait for Guru Sahib to bless me. And do Ardas, and then Maharaj will bless you, show you your past life, and then you won't be so skeptical about it. But I don't think you're bad people if you don't agree with reincarnation. Like I've said in the reincarnation video, whether you believe in reincarnation or not is irrelevant. It's going to happen to you anyways, like the laws of physics. As long as you're a good person, you're reading your part, nickname, that's fine. It's just that when you step onto a pracharic stage, you have to say things that unite people. And if everybody's believing one thing and you start cutting away at the roots of their faith, which is Gurbani, I don't think you should be given a stage. Okay. I just think that anybody who's going to go out there and teach Sikhi, when it comes to street prachar, we don't really discriminate with people that are not Amritari. So we let people that are not Amritari do street prachar. But in a safe way, in a sense that we give them a script, we give them leaflets that don't allow them to go off and do something which goes against Sikhi. And certainly, if we were in a street prachar environment and we were filming someone that did said something was very strange and against Sikhi, we wouldn't put that in a video and put it online because we don't want to spread something which is untrue. Now, yes, you feel that strongly about Sikhi. And bootstrapping Sikhi by streamlining it in a coherent framework, and la la, I'm not sure what this means. But we need to work together, agreed. And the future of Panth depends upon working together and put our differences aside. But I think that we work with anybody, but if you are in a state, if you can't answer the questions that I've said to you today, if you can't sit in a forum and explain why you think that all the Bani we've talked about is not true and that your view is more true based upon some Gurbani, if you can't do that, you shouldn't be preaching Sikhi in this kind of online forum, which is breaking people's faith. You know, you should really try and educate yourself more about what Gurbani is saying. That's my view, whether you like it or not. It's fair enough. But I've never hated anybody or wouldn't work with them. But I wouldn't let them do prachar. I wouldn't put that video up on our channel. I wouldn't let them do prachar in a stage that we control. I wouldn't recommend them if someone was against reincarnation, say, oh, what do you think about this guy? If he doesn't believe in reincarnation, doesn't believe in Dharam Rajan, I wouldn't put them on a stage. I'd say, no, I don't think you should put them on a stage. I think we should. I think the point here, the next person, the number, the second question again. I think we need to have discussions about things we don't agree upon. And I would be very happy to sit with anybody from any background and talk about Sikhi. And I don't think that no one needs to get into a frenzy and walk off and, you know, feel dukhi. I think that this person is right. I'm not sure what the name is, but it's the question 30. Not being able to discuss our theological differences in a civilized manner has hurt our panth numerous times in the past, and I agree with that. So we shouldn't repeat the mistakes, and let's make a platform where we can work together and talk to each other. I just, you know, again, I come back to this, and the question is that whoever makes a view should back it up with Gurbani. I don't think you should put up a view, like in our videos, and even in this video, right? I've tried as many times to give Gurbani references that back up what I'm saying. And I think that if anybody's going to go online and start making videos and explaining Sikhi to the wider public, it's very dangerous if they don't know what Sikhi is in the first place. And everything should be coming from Gurbani. The question is, what platform does Base of Sikhi have for discussing these differences? We people on this forum would love to talk some about the Sikh concepts in depth with us so we can understand each other. But what is that platform look like? The comment section on YouTube is not very conducive, and there's no guarantee we'll reply. And again, with tweets and Facebook. Look, we're not really built at the moment for this in an online way. I tell you what does exist in a physical way. Every Sunday, you know, at 7:30 p.m. after the katha and a half an hour break, I'm available at Park Avenue Gurdwara for a discussion with the Sangat for about an hour and a half. That is a real time. I've been here for about 2 hours now. That is a real way that we can discuss things in an open forum, and you'll have lots of people that come to that Sangat every Sunday. The second thing is, wherever I travel, you know, I'm always available for Q&As, and I set them up. So I'm not sure what much more we can do. We haven't got a full-time web designer. We haven't got, you know, a big thing. If you want to fly out here and discuss things with me, let's do it. You want to do a Google Hangout? You want to set one up with like 3-4 of you? Let's do it. But please, please, please bring some Gurbani to back up what you're saying. I'm not here to debate with people about concepts that they've conjured up from their own mind. It's got to be based on Gurbani. People think that forums are the best way. It's structured neatly. I'm not sure. I don't really like forums that much. And again, that's just my personal view. Maybe it's from the fact that I've seen forums turn into argument places and people misunderstand the tone that was intended when you say something. And that's not good. And wouldn't it be great if Basics took a lead role in intra-faith discussion? I may be biased, but I think that Reddit r/sikh is the best place to do this. Probably biased about that. So we don't have a place. We can try and have a place. I'm still not convinced about the good thing about forums. But you know, as I said, this is my first time on this forum. You can take this video. It'd be interesting to see your views and your comments. I do hope that people watch this video. We've come to the end. Thank you for your time in doing this. I know, not a problem. I appreciate that. It's the first time I've done a live Q&A. We've been talking about it for a long time. We should do some live Q&As, but we never did it. So this has prompted that. The questions have been the things that I'd expected to see, because I've seen some of the threads that have gone up before on r/sikh on your forum. And yes, in a way, you know, to be honest, the reason that I've not engaged so far is because a lot of them seemed about stuff that was so straightforward, you know. And I was like, where is it coming from? Oh, sorry. Can you move around here? Okay. And I was just wondering, like, why would someone question some of the things that are so blatant in Gurbani without giving some Gurbani that says they don't exist? So, but thank you for watching. Apologies if I've offended anybody, I do hope this video was helpful to the people that are watching now on Facebook and YouTube and etc. Please thank you for arranging this time and the questions. Especially thank you to the Singh who put together and collated all the questions into one thread in an easy way that I could scroll. I think his Reddit name is Chardikala. So you're being Chardikala by putting things together there. Thank you so much. Okay, G, it's late now. I'm tired, so forgive me for my mistakes. And chutti baksho, puna chuka dikhe maji, Waheguru Ji ka khalsa, Waheguru Ji ki fateh.